Welcome to my talk about web components. Very early today, I hope your party yesterday was as nice as mine. So, well, you can see if you want to tweet, there's my Twitter handle. And I'm working for a huge company in Switzerland, so we always have disclaimers, as every huge company has disclaimers. In short, if you do what I tell you today, if you repeat everything and you delete the internet, it's not our fault. After my talk, I show this slide again. There you can download my slides, all the code from the examples, and the video. Okay, first to me. My name is Markus Filon. I'm working in Switzerland for an insurance company as a software engineer, agile coach. I'm working as a lecturer one day a week for a university, and I'm teaching there web engineering, and I'm speaking at conferences like today. This is my third time in English, so if you have any feedback for me, I appreciate it. And I'm writing articles for magazines and books, but in German. I am member of the board of the Java user group in Switzerland, as you can see here. So I'm responsible for organizing events and workshops in central Switzerland. And if you are there for holiday, vacation, or maybe for work, you can contact me and we can organize something. This is the agenda for my talk today. I have a very short introduction. Then I explain you the specifications. Web components has four specifications. Then I show you some goodies, which have no direct relationship to web components, but are very useful. The actual status, the browser support, and then the biggest part, I hope, the live coding, where I explain everything in practice. Okay, the intro, I was very lazy. I copied the intro from Wikipedia because it's very short and very good. And the sense is that web components were developed by Google engineers as part of the W3C to allow the creation of reusable widgets and components for the web. You already know this from Java. You have components in Swing, you have components in JavaFX, and now you have components in the web. The very important thing of this is that web components is a W3C standard. It's not a library from a third-party vendor, from Google or something. It's a standard. And this allows the reuse of every component. It has four specifications. I explain the specifications on the following slides. And there's no new technology. You use HTML, CSS, and JavaScript to write your components. Maybe there's one, two new tags, but that's everything. And for working with web components, you do not need any library. You can do it with plain HTML and CSS and JavaScript. But a library can be very handy to save some lines of code and to develop faster. Okay, the four specifications. The first one is a template specification. With the template specification, you can define parts of your HTML file, which can be reused anywhere, at any time, any number of times. Therefore, you have a new tag, the template tag. Here you see an example. So the template tag can have an ID. You can reference this template by this ID and use it as many times as you want. But that's only a small part of web components. Another part is the shadow DOM. Because if we have a template, and the template contains CSS, it contains IDs, and you have this template three times on your same website, we have a problem, because IDs are only allowed to be once. They have to be unique on the page. And maybe the CSS of one template interferes with the CSS of a different template. That's why they introduced Shadow DOM. So every component, later on, has its own DOM. So every CSS which is contained in a component only works for this component and has no effect outside the component. And then you have custom elements. The custom element specification brings the other two specifications together, the template specification and the shadow DOM specification. And it defines how to create your own component. For example, this can be a component. You have a tag you can use. And it's important that you have such a hyphen in your name, because this is a way the browser identifies a web component. Standard HTML tags have never hyphens in their name. And the last specification is the import specification. Components make only sense if you have them, for example, at the central place, and you can import them everywhere you want, like classes in Java. And that's what the import specification makes possible. So you have an import here. It's a link like stylesheet, but with a value of import. And if you import a component, which is an HTML file, you can use it everywhere, just with a tag. So you have two lines of code, one import and one usage. Okay, now the goodies. When we have Shadow DOM, we have the problem that CSS is only inside of the component. But how can you style a component if you can't access the elements inside of the component because they are in a Shadow DOM? You can do this with variables. If you develop a component, you can specify variables. You have to document them. And if someone uses this component, he can take a look at the documentation, take a look at the variables, and specify the variables outside of the component, and you can use them inside. And CSS has variables, so just use them. We will do this later in the live coding part. And we not only have variables, we have mixins too. The difference is variables have only one value, and mixins is some kind of object. It's a key value pair. And you apply it differently. And here I should mention, if you use a variable, you can specify the variable name and a default. And if someone specified this variable, then the value of this variable is used, otherwise the default. You can't specify a default for the apply here, but you can add your code inside. Okay, so status, very important. Which browser can use web components? Well, everyone. There is native support completed in Chrome on Opera here, as you can see, and the others are working on it, and you can use web components in the other browsers with a polyfill. Polyfill is very stable, works very nice. A lot of applications use web components. The actual status of the browsers you can see at webcomponents.org website. Then you have some libraries. I don't want to explain the libraries now, because we don't have so much time, and I want to show you how to use and create web components. Later on, I will do a demo with Polymer. It's a famous one, but there are other ones too. Very interesting is that Xtech here is sponsored and supported by Microsoft. Okay, so let's start with the live coding part. First, I want to show you how to create a web component without any additional library. So, this is just an empty project, and I create a new file. Plain HTML file, let's call this simple, and let's make this bigger. So I think this is big enough. Simple example. And we have just a simple HTML5 file, nothing special here. And now let's add a script, because web components uses JavaScript. You need JavaScript to create your components. A component is a class. We have a class here, my component, and it has to extend HTML element. And inside of the class, you can have callbacks. For example, a callback when the component was inserted into the page, when you use the component. This is a connected callback. And here you can do whatever you want. For example, you can do this. This refers to your own component. And you can specify inner HTML to be this is Geekon. So and it should be extends, not extend. And everything looks fine now. So now we created a web component, but the browser does not know anything about it. We have to register the web component so the browser knows that it exists. Therefore, we have an object called custom elements. And in this object, we can call the define method. And here we have two parameters. The first one is a tag for our component. Let's say it is my dash component. The dash is very important. If you forgot the dash, you won't have any error message. It just does not work. And the second parameter is a class name, my component. That's it. We created our first component. That's everything. No magic. Just a few lines of JavaScript. And in our body, we can now use our component. Let's create an H1, for example, test. And here we can just add our tag, my dash component. And we should close it. We should not use the short handle for closing, this one here. So often this does not work because web components are non-void tags. So close them with a separate closing tag. So this is everything you need, and you have a component. Nothing special. We can take a look now. How does it look like? Test, or I did a mistake anywhere. Doctype HTML. Class my component extends HTML element. Connected. Oh yeah. With a small b. Sometimes such things are very important. And of course you don't get error messages. It's web technology. You know? So you can have fun with it. A lot of fun. Okay, it works. And this is very simple, and yeah, just a few lines of code. But we can do this much simpler. We do not have to write JavaScript code. We can use a library which does this for us, and we can focus on writing HTML code. And well, if you take a look at this, it's not really looking nice. We don't have CSS here, nothing. We can use a library which provides us components which are already written for us, which have CSS styles and so on. For example, you know the material paper guidelines, and well, let's use this for our application. But first, let's take a look. What do we want to achieve today? I would like to write an application together with you, which looks like this. Of course, it's a demo application. It's a very simple dashboard. We have some servers on this dashboard. The server have nice names. They have images to display. We have the data of the servers here, IP addresses, usage of CPU, memory, and disk. And if you take a look at this application, it's very interesting for web components because you have such components. And not only one, 7 or 8 of this. So let's write this as a component. And I prefer to put my application in an own component, this one, so we can add the application on every page we like just with two lines of code, the import and the tag. So we are very, very flexible. And of course, when we take a look here, this is a progress bar. We do not want to write progress bars on our own. There's a website, customelements.io. There are more than 2,500 components we can still use for our application. So we write two own applications, and we use third-party components, two own components, and we use third-party components. And when we take a look here, of course, this component here can access the server and ask the server for his data to display. But then we have, for example, 7 requests. And the more server we have, the more requests we have. So let's do this, the application. The application does a request to a server, and you get back a JSON containing all information about all servers. So for us, this is very interesting because now we need to interact between the two components. If one component has the data and another component has to display this data, we have to move the data from one component to the other. Okay, let's try this. What I have here, it's an empty project. No, nearly empty. Let's delete this. Not needed now. It's a nearly empty project. We have a README, of course, doesn't matter. Gitignore, doesn't matter. We have a directory containing the images. Well, that's okay. We don't want to do image manipulation today. And here we have an API folder containing the JSON file. That's everything we have. We have no component here, no HTML file, well, except our simple test here. We can throw this away. So we start from scratch. Take a look at the JSON file. This is very easy. We have the name, IP, CPU, memory disk, hard-coded now, but this doesn't matter. And before we start, one important thing. If you develop web component, it's very important that you have a web server. If you don't have a web server, Safari doesn't work fine opening components with a file URL, but it's the only browser I know which supports web components on file URL. All other browsers need to access your components using an HTTP request. So you need a local web server, for example, integrated in your development environment or your as an editor plugin. Okay, so let's start. Here I have my notes, talking in English and writing. It's better to have my notes here. So, because we use third-party components, I like to have a dependency manager, or to use a dependency manager. A very famous one on the web environment is Boer. So we just start a new project with Boer in it. The questions are now not very important for us. Simply leave everything the default. So now we have a Boer file. Yes, that looks okay. And if we open the Boer file here, there's nothing special in it. We have a name, home page, authors, description, main, license, some ignore. No dependencies. Now let's use Polymer for our application. Polymer provides support for material design. So we can install this using Boer install with --save. It will be added to the Boer JSON file, and it's polymer-polymer. Now Boer will install the Polymer component, and it will respect all dependencies from this component. So we do not only get Polymer, we get, for example, here it's webcomponents.js. This is a polyfill. The polyfill is a dependency of Polymer itself. Okay, now we have this. And yeah, let's just look at the configuration file. It's a Boer config. Now we have two new lines here, a dependency section with Polymer. And of course, we check this Boer JSON in. We add it to our Git repository. And we do not need to add the Boer components directory to our Git repository. This was automatically created, and it contains the components downloaded by Boer, each component in a separate directory. And we can delete this, we don't need it. And if we delete it and we need it again, for example, if you check it out and have an empty Bower components directory, or it's not existing, just use Bower install, and it will install everything again. So you keep your Git repository clean. Okay, and now let's start our project with an HTML file, just a plain HTML5 file. Let's name this index with the title of dashboard. Now, so that every browser now can use our application, we should add the polyfill. The polyfill is just a JavaScript. It's located in the Bower components directory, of course, there in the web components JS directory, and it's called web components lite. That's okay for us. And now we can use web components. And Polymer itself is a component. So we use link with the relationship of import and then reference to Bower components, Polymer HTML. So now we have imported the Polymer component. We need this for our own components later on. And now, now let's create our first own component, but not inside of our HTML file. It would be cool if we have a separate file we can import from everywhere and use this everywhere else. So let's create a directory for our own components. Let's call this app components, doesn't matter. And inside this directory, for every of our components, we create an own directory. Let's name our component dashboard app. And here we create an HTML file which contains our component with the same name. This is a convention. Dashboard app HTML. And we delete everything here from the template, so it's just empty. Now we write our component. We can start with a tag. Maybe you don't know this. It's a DOM module tag. And here we specify an ID. And the ID is a tag name. Let's use the tag dashboard app. And inside of our component, we can use a template. And here, let's write it works, just for now. And we use Polymer as a library, so we have to register our element at Polymer. We do this with a script. We call the Polymer. And now I have to look because of the braces here, two round braces, curly braces, and a semicolon. That's always fun. And it has a property called is, and here we repeat the name of our component. So that's everything. We have our DOM module with the tag name here as an ID, a template, and we register the component at Polymer. Now let's look if it works. Oh, well, it would not work because we have to import this. Link rel import. Here we import our own component. We added this to the app components directory, dashboard app HTML. And now we can use the tag. And as you can see, for example, this is now IntelliJ, but there are a lot of other IDEs which support web components. He already recognized that we did an import, and he knows the tag we created. Okay, let's start this. Well, here it works. So what do we have now? We have an HTML file, plain HTML5. And inside of our HTML file, we have a component. Oops, let's zoom here. And if we take a look here, you see we have a dashboard app tag. So it's not a replacement. We have a real component, we can open it, we can look inside, and ooh, we have a shadow DOM. And inside of the shadow DOM, we only have text now. So we do not see the template tag, we do not see the script tag, because what happens is that this, what we have here specified in our template, was used as a component. The surroundings here are only to make it work. Okay, but that's not enough for us. We do not want only static text. Well, a title would be great. We want to make an AJAX request to a server to get the JSON. AJAX requests are very funny in JavaScript with an XHTML, HTTP request, and well, I don't like this. And we can use jQuery, of course. Don't like this too. It's much easier because we have web components. We can use a component which executes an AJAX request for us. Let's take a look at webcomponents.org or custom-elements.org. This is a directory of more than 2,500 components. And one of these is called Iron AJAX. And this Iron AJAX component does an AJAX request for us, just with HTML, as you can see here. We have to import this component. And if you take a look at the description, you have the opportunity to install this via Bower. And you can copy and paste this command. Then it will be installed. And of course, with all dependencies, and it will be added to our Bower JSON configuration file as a dependency for our application. Okay, now let's use this. But before we can use this, we have to import it. And like in Java, the imports and the web components are at the top of the file, not inside of the DOM module in top. So link rel import. And if we specify the import here, we have to be to specify it relative to our component. Not relative to our application, relative to our component. So we have to go up to directories, then down to Bower components, to Iron AJAX HTML. We don't have to search which file we have to import because, well, it's standard that we use the same name as a component. And now we can use it here. Let's create an AJAX request just with using the new Iron AJAX tag. And we specify here auto, which automatically executes the request after the page is loaded or the component was inserted. Of course, we have to specify the URL. Oops. And the URL is, let me see, what do we have a prefix here? Yes, it's called dashboard. And here, API metrics JSON. And now we have to specify which format we expect in the response. And we do this with handle S, and here we specify JSON. And what should be done with the response? It should be put into a variable. Please create a variable for us containing the response, the JSON object. And we can do this by specifying last response. So every new response would modify the existing variable and replace the value with a new response. And variables are specified with two curly braces. let's use Ajax response. The name doesn't matter. And now we have an Ajax request. Let's take a look what happens here. Maybe it's a network tab. If we reload the page, then we see here we have an access to the matrix.json file without a single line of JavaScript. That's pretty cool because the XML HTTP request is not very funny to use. Okay, now let's use the response. The response is an JSON file. And if you take a look at the JSON file, we will see that it is an array of objects, JavaScript array of JavaScript objects. And arrays are very cool because what we can do now, we can add a template inside of our template. And we have the possibility to repeat this template. We can specify is DOM repeat. And we can repeat it as many times as we have entries in our array list, just by specifying items equals. And here we use the same variable name, Ajax response. And inside of our template, we can output the value. In Java, if you specify a loop, we specify the variable inside of the loop. In web components, we have this automatically specified. It's called item. So let's access item by using two curly braces, item dot name. I think, let's look, item dot name. So we expect to see Merkur, Venus, and so on. Save this, reload our application, and here it is. And now we have an application which contains the same template 7 or 8 times. Just with plain HTML and some JavaScript in the background. And for example, I use Chrome for the demo. Chrome supports it natively. Okay, but we do not want to display the data here. We want a second component and we want to interact between these two components. How does this work? First, let's create a second component. Therefore, we need a second directory. How did I name it? Info panel. And here, of course, we create an HTML file with the same name and delete everything inside. Don't need the template. And well, I'm lazy, so I copy this over. And we do not want an Ajax request. Let's delete the stuff. And the name is different. It is info-panel. Info-panel. So now we have a new component. But now we need to transfer the data. How could this be done? Very easy. We can specify our own tags. Well, now we can specify our own attributes and use the attribute to move the data from one component to the other. And to specify a known attribute, we have to add here a property to the Polymer call. It is called properties. Properties is an object. And here we can add as many attributes as we want. Let's use server data as an attribute. And we have to specify the type of the attribute. In our case, it's a JavaScript object. So we just add type colon object. And we can add a default value null. Specifying a default is optional, but let's do this now. And now we have a variable and an attribute. The content of the attribute is added to a variable with the same name. So here in our template, we can now write server data app.name. Okay, let's add this to our application. First, of course, we need to import our new component. Link rel import up one directory down to info panel, info panel HTML. Now we have imported it, now we can use it. Here in our template, let's replace item.name with a call to our own component called info panel. And now, as you can see, IntelliJ and other IDEs recognize that we have a new attribute. And here in our attribute, we can refer to the item variable. And that's it, we are done. And what happens now is that our component called InfoPanel is added as many times to our application as we have entries in the array. Let's check if it works. It works. We have the same output with the planets here. But now the output is not done in our application, it's done in a different component called InfoPanel. Okay, now we need to display the data here. We have the name, we have the IP address and so on, but we want to have a different layout. If we look at this, we have such components here. And we can create this on our own and style this with a lot of CSS, making it looking nice. But well, someone else did this already for us. Again, we go to webcomponents.org, and there are a lot of components which start with paper, with they have material design. For example, there's a component called paper card. Here's some usage examples, and we see some demos. And well, if you take a look here, this is an image in on top, and here's some content, and we have all the nice material design elements. Let's use this. Install via Boa, just copy the command, execute it. And here. And now let's add it to our component. First we need to import. If we do not import, we have an unknown tag, and unknown tags are ignored without any error. So we can have a lot of fun with this. And now two directories up, Boa components, paper card HTML. Import done. Let's use this. Paper card already recognized. And paper card has a few attributes. We can take a look here. It's a paper card. We have a demo. We can open the demo here. So we see different paper cards in action with images, without images, and you can copy the examples from below. And you have a description of the API. And if you take a look here at the API, you can see, for example, the styling. So the developer of this component specified a few variables, and if you want to change the styling of the component, the colors, you can use it by specifying these variables in your CSS. And here we have the API reference, the properties. The properties become the attributes. But be careful, if you take a look here, animated shadow, we have camel case. In HTML, camel case is converted to a notation with a hyphen. So in HTML, we specify the attribute using animated dash shadow with lowercase spelling. But in the documentation, the JavaScript side, it is camel case. Okay, here we can take a look. For example, we see heading, string, the title of the card, image, string, the URL of the title, image of the card, and that's what we want. We want to display an image, and we want to add a heading. Let's do this, image and heading. So paper card, heading equals, here we can use our variable server data dot name, and an image. And the image is in the directory dashboard images. It has the name of the server as the image name, so we can copy this. Dot png, I think. JPEG, okay. Now let's reload our page, our application. And here it is. Huge images. Let's make it a little bit smaller. Okay, but we have a, well, we have a problem. We can't see the name here. We have to style this. Now let's look. What do we need to style this name? Back to the styling part. Oh, here we have paper card header image text. Mix in applied to the text overlapping the image in the card header section. We use this. Now we add a style section to our template. Very important to have it as a part of our template. And we want to style the paper card. So let's specify paper card. And inside of the paper card, let's add the variable name, colon. And here we specify, for example, color white. Just reload. And the color switched to white. Because now we specify this variable, and inside of the component, inside of the paper card component, it looks for the variable. Now it is set, and it uses the value of the variable. If the variable is not set, it defaults to black. Okay, this is how to style. And now we need to add the data, of course. Therefore, we can use another component, a progress bar. So let's look for a progress bar with material design, paper progress. Let's use this one. Of course, copy it, copy and paste. And here you can see the examples. Looks really nice. We add the import. Oops. We need to import it first, of course. To install it. Link rel import our components directory, paper progress. And please take a look at the website. There are thousands of components, tables, whatever you need, you find everything there. And now, inside of our paper card, we can just edit. For example, let's say CPU colon paper progress. Well, how to specify the value? Let's take a look. Value equals and the number. So value equals and the number. And the number, of course, is in our variable server data.cpu. It's a JSON file. And now if we reload our application, we see the CPU data displayed as a progress bar. Okay, I do not have much time left, so I do not add now the disk and memory. It's exactly the same. Just copy this and change the values here. So, what do we have now? We have a plain HTML5 file which contains one component for our whole application. It's the index file. So in our index file, we import our application and we just have a tag. And on every page, someone comes and wants to show the dashboard, just add the import, just add the tag, and you are done. For example, you can add the files to a static directory anywhere or in your company. Okay. So, web components, my opinion, are very declarative to write. They are reusable, just import them from everywhere. You can combine them, you can extend them, and of course you can interoperate between your components. And this is the first time in web environment that it allows to encapsulate your component. You have a shadow DOM. So if you have something inside of your shadow DOM, like CSS, it does not interfere with other components. You can use the same IDs, the same classes, doesn't matter. You are very productive with it, especially if you use components which are available for free on webcomponents.org. If you write your own components, you can add them there. And yeah, of course, you're using a standard, a web components standard. And which is very, very nice. Now you can really do components, you can think in components like you do in Java with Swing, JavaFX, and so on. Okay, here I have some links. At first, the specification and an introduction from the W3C. Of course, the directory of the web components, growing every day. And the Polymer project, which I like very much. It's the most used library for web components, actually. Okay, thank you very much. And if you want, please download the slides here, the code, and take some, maybe take some time for the video to show up there. Thank you very much.